Thank you so much, Dr. Chang, for that rousing presentation. You heard it here first. Our next speaker is Clyde William Namu’o, the Executive Director of the Native Hawaiian Roll Commission. Mr. Namu’o is also Chief Executive Officer of the Polynesian Voyaging Society, which many of you know is a nonprofit established to perpetuate the art and science of traditional Polynesian voyaging. And just to remind everybody, if you're here in Washington, D.C. in May, the Hokulea Voyaging Canoe will be coming here to Washington, D.C., and there will be another major event here at NMAI at that time. But back to Mr. Namu’o, who from 2001 to 2011 served as Chief Executive Officer of the Office of Hawaiian Affairs. And before this, he was Deputy Administrative Director of the State of Hawaii Courts. He serves on the board of several nonprofit organizations. Clyde will be presenting on the case for federal recognition. Please welcome Clyde Namu’o.
Aloha mai kakou. Good afternoon, everyone. Let me just introduce myself again. As Doug said, you know, I spent the first 30 years of my career working for the Hawaii State Judiciary, and the last 10 years of that was spent working in the Hawaii Supreme Court as a Deputy Administrative Director of the Judiciary. So, you know, I don't know if you've ever worked in a legal setting like that, but people tend to speak in whispers when they speak to you. Now, they don't always speak nicely to you, but they say it in a whisper. So that's the good thing. In the year 2001, I thought, well, you know, I've been playing it safe for most of my life, so now it's time to try something different. And the administrator at the Office of Hawaiian Affairs had left. And for those of you who have kept up with Hawaii and its history over the many, many years, probably know that the Office of Hawaiian Affairs has had a very interesting history. It was never known as the calmest place to work. So I thought, well, what the heck, you know, you got to step out there every now and again. So in 2001, on a fluke, I submitted my name, and then I got a phone call from the recruiter over at OHA saying, oh, the board has just voted and they've, you know, they're gonna hire you as their chief administrator. And I said, oh, okay, well then I run across the hallway and I talked to the Chief Justice, and because I hadn't told him that I was thinking about leaving. So anyway, I get hired and I go to my first meeting and they're literally screaming across the table. And I thought, okay, well, this is not quite what the Supreme Court does, but you know, the good news is that they tell it to you right in your face, and so that's great. But that may have been an omen, I'm not sure. But in 2001, when I started with OHA, and it was August of 2001, so it was 1 month before September 11th, and that perhaps was another omen. I stayed there for 10 years. I retired from the Office of Hawaiian Affairs in 2011, and that was the most rewarding 10-year period in my life. We spent so many countless days up here in Washington, D.C., lobbying for the federal recognition legislation. And, you know, I learned a lot because having worked in the judiciary for so long, I really did not have a connection to my Hawaiian roots. So spending time at OHA, I really had a better opportunity to learn a lot more about what it meant to be Hawaiian. And I don't, you know, I can't say that I agree with what Professor Chang shared with us this afternoon, but I certainly do agree that it's his right to pursue that avenue and to do it as best as he possibly can. What I would also suggest is that there's not one answer. There's not one conclusion to this issue of Hawaiian sovereignty, that really what we may be looking at is a process, a step-by-step process. And what I'd like to speak with you today about is this issue of federal recognition. And it's not really the federal recognition part that I'm going to talk about. It's really the nation within a nation part that is probably more significant. And I'm going to start with a little bit of history about the Akaka bill, because over the many, many years that we worked very closely with Senator Akaka in putting that bill together and helping to lobby to advance it, there have been so many iterations that I think people will say, well, which version are you talking about? And actually use that as an opportunity to discredit the effort to create a better life for Native Hawaiians, which is really, at the end of the day, that's really what this is all about, making a better life for Native Hawaiians. That's really what is most pressing. So I'd like to start at 1993, which was the 100th anniversary of the overthrow of the Native Hawaiian government. And I have a hard time using the term anniversary because it sounds like it's a celebration. And honestly, it is not a celebration. It was never viewed as a celebration amongst Hawaiian people at all. But it was 100 years from when they took the throne away from our queen. Now, what happened in Washington, D.C., and we must be very thankful to Senator Kaka and Senator Inouye, and to Esther Kia'aina. Esther is now the Assistant Secretary at the Department of the Interior. Esther worked for Senator Kaka, and it was Esther Kia'aina who really helped to push the apology resolution. People somehow have forgotten over these several years, you know, it just seemed to evolve and it just happened and it passed. It didn't just happen and pass. It took a lot of lobbying to get that resolution adopted. And what that resolution said, I'm going to cite a few sections of it. It says, the Congress, on the occasion of the 100th anniversary of the illegal overthrow of the Kingdom of Hawaii on January 17, 1893, acknowledges the historical significance of this event, which resulted in the suppression of the inherent sovereignty of the Native Hawaiian people. Two, recognizes and commends the efforts of reconciliation initiated by the State of Hawaii and the United Church of Christ with Native Hawaiians. And that's the word, that's that key word in the resolution, in the apology bill, reconciliation. So when President Clinton signed the joint when President Clinton signed the apology resolution in 1993 and it became a public law, that notion of reconciliation really stuck, especially with Senator Kaka. And what happened after that resolution was adopted, Senator Kaka formed a number of working groups. And so when we talk about, well, what next? Because the United States said, we're sorry, we really screwed up, and we're very sorry. Now, Senator Kaka said, well, okay, what does that term reconciliation, what does that mean? And how can we bring substance to that phrase reconciliation? So, excuse me, never get sick. When Governor Waiahe said he couldn't come up and he said, you're going, that's when I got sick, sorry. So I apologize. When I see him again, I'll tell him. So Senator Kaka said, okay, well, let's put together a bunch of working groups. And that's what he did. So the Kaka bill did not just come out of thin air. It was really based on a number of working groups that were formed throughout the state of Hawaii. How do we address this issue? Because Senator Kaka firmly believed that there needed to be some kind of reconciliation that occurred between the United States and the state of Hawaii. And so after several years, the working groups came up with this notion that, you know, a nation within a nation, which of course is the Indian model that many of us look at, a nation within a nation is the model that we really should seriously consider adopting for Hawaii. Now, when you look at the Kaka bill, and the first version of the Kaka bill was introduced in the year 2000, and as is the practice, the bill is introduced into both the House and the Senate. So that was the very first version of the Kaka bill in the year 2000. Now, when you look at the bill over its many, many iterations, what you'll see that in the first version and in future versions of the bill, it included a lengthy section about organizing the Native Hawaiian people. I would say that the bulk of the bill really concentrated on this business of how do we organize, how do we create a Native Hawaiian governing entity? Because when you talk about federal recognition, what the federal government would really be recognizing is that Native Hawaiian governing entity. And in Senator Akaka's mind, his position was that we don't have, and we did not have, a Native Hawaiian governing entity since the overthrow of the kingdom in 1893. So the bill really concentrated on, okay, well, you know, you have to do this, and you have to be Native Hawaiian, and you have to participate in cultural activities in order to be considered as a eligible Native Hawaiian to participate in the forming of a Native Hawaiian government. And over the many years, that portion of the Akaka bill became so problematic. It went through an evolution, and people were very offended by some of the terms that were used in that section of the bill, because this notion that we are not a tribe, and we are not a tribe. And if you do that to Hawaiians and you say, hey, well, you guys are a tribe, right? They'll tell you, we're not a tribe, and I find that very offensive. So the language about organizing this Native Hawaiian governing entity by far was the most problematic piece in the bill. Now comes the Department of Justice, and they're saying that, okay, if your real end game for the Akaka bill is to go for federal recognition, then you need to make sure that you form a governing entity that would qualify for federal recognition. Because if you go to the Department of the Interior and you look at the criteria for federally recognized tribes, there's a very specific criteria. If a tribe goes through an administrative process for recognition, which can be done, but that is not a process that is open to Native Hawaiians. It is a process, the administrative process is open to tribes as well as communities in Alaska. But the administrative rules were never extended to Hawaii. So going for an administrative recognition was not possible. And that's why Senator Kaka felt that there are really just three ways to get federally recognized. One would be through an act of Congress, which was the Akaka bill. Number two, the administrative process through the Department of the Interior, or three, through an executive order by the president. And so the idea was that he wanted the congressional route, which is the reason for the Akaka bill. But as this went on, and in the year 2010, what happened was that Senator Akaka had announced that he was not going to be seeking re-election. And the legislature back home said, oh my goodness, or at least the Hawaiian caucus of the legislature in Hawaii said, oh my goodness, without our advocate, without Senator Akaka in Congress, the chances of the Akaka bill passing are very, very slim. And so what they did in Hawaii was to pass what is known as Act 195. What Act 195 does is that it creates the Native Hawaiian Roll Commission, because many people agree that as you form a Native Hawaiian governing entity, the first thing that you need to do is to actually register people. And that's why the Office of Hawaiian Affairs in 2002 started Kaui Noa. And I see a lot of faces in the audience who have been around since 2002. When the Office of Hawaiian Affairs came to the Washington, D.C. area, as well as cities across the United States, trying to register as many Hawaiians as possible. And Kaui Noa, at the end of the campaign in 2010, registered over 120,000 Hawaiians. There are really 500,000 Native Hawaiians across the United States. So even though it was a significant number, certainly not enough. There should have been more people to be registered, and perhaps some that'll happen at some point in the future. Anyway, so the Akaka bill is never successful. It made it through the House twice, the U.S. House twice. And we can thank Representative Abercrombie when he was in Congress. He was one of those that really helped to get past the bill through the House. It crossed over to the Senate. the bill never, ever, in all the years that the bill was introduced, and I'm sure there's a version of the bill out there in Congress today, it never made it through the U.S. Senate. Now, what the Office of Hawaiian Affairs did was we hired the Pattenbaugh's law firm back in 2002, and we spent millions of dollars lobbying for the Akaka bill. And one of the reasons why there was a real concern about passing the Akaka bill was that the challenge to Native Hawaiian programs, some of you will remember the lawsuits against Kamehameha schools, the lawsuits against the Hawaiian Homes Commission Act that literally would have taken away the Hawaiian homesteads. Kamehameha schools would have been closed. And we were lucky that those two major lawsuits that were filed in the year 2001 never ended up going to court on the substance of the lawsuit. It got dismissed on procedural grounds, so we were lucky. But that's one of the practical reasons why many people felt that we needed federal recognition. We needed to have something that said, okay, you know, we're gonna recognize the indigenous nature of Native Hawaiians, and they're protected, their programs are protected. That was really one of the impetus. That was the impetus for wanting to get the Akaka bill passed. And there was real concern because there are over 150 pieces of federal regulations that provide funding to Native Hawaiian programs throughout the state of Hawaii and beyond. And the problem with that is that many of those programs are passed because Senator Inoue, who we have fond memories of, had the power to pass all of these pieces of legislation. The Bishop Museum appreciated funding that was earmarked specifically for them because Senator Inoue was able to do that. And so those bills, those 150 measures, we all understood that at some point in the future could be challenged because the issue of recognizing Native Hawaiians as an entity had not yet been resolved. So where we are today and how is the state of Hawaii going to fit into this? So the Roll Commission, and Governor Waihe'e is the chair of the Native Hawaiian Roll Commission, the way that bill was drafted in 2011, and I was just getting ready to leave the Office of Hawaiian Affairs at the end of 2011, so I helped to work on the language of that piece of legislation that ultimately did pass. And the way the bill is drafted, we create a certified list of Native Hawaiians, which is what we have been working on since 2012. So it's been approximately 3.5 years that we've tried to put the list together. The Kauinoa names were merged with the Native Hawaiian roll that was established. So all told, we're probably in the neighborhood of 100,000 certified Native Hawaiians that are on Kana'i Oluwalu, which is a Native Hawaiian roll. So the way Act 195 was drafted, though, it says that the list will be turned over to the state of Hawaii once we are done. Now, Governor Waihe'e has said, okay, well, we're not done. Even though there will be the AHA, as Professor Chang said, that will start on Monday, as far as the governor is concerned, we're not done. And the list has been partially certified, but we are not turning it over to the state. And I think what the governor really intends to do is to hold on to the list until the Native Hawaiian governing entity comes into being, and the list then would be turned over to the Native Hawaiian government. So that's the plan, if you will, once the AHA is convened. And the procedure that is being followed with the creation of the AHA back home, and I know that some of the members of the Native Hawaiian community here in Washington, D.C. Darlene Butts, are you here in the audience? Darlene, former president of the Hawaiian Civic Club here in Washington, D.C., member of the Royal State Society here in D.C., is a delegate to the convention, and I expect to see her on Monday. So as we worked on registering Hawaiians and trying to build this Hawaiian nation, if you will, there was a real concern amongst those of us who worked for the Office of Hawaiian Affairs to make sure that Hawaiians all had the opportunity to participate. And so when we tried to register as many Hawaiians as possible, the idea was that we were not simply going to exclude people who lived, people who lived outside of Hawaii from participating in trying to reestablish this Native Hawaiian governing entity. We wanted to be sure that every Hawaiian, regardless of where he or she lived, would have that opportunity. And so we did try very hard to register as many Hawaiians as possible. So I'm a delegate to the convention as well that starts on Monday. Part of me is not looking forward to it. I spent 10 years with the Office of Hawaiian Affairs. They consider me now the longest serving administrator for OHA. And some people would say, well, that you deserve a medal for doing that. And some people say, well, you must have been crazy. That's why you did it. I'm not sure. It's probably somewhere in between. But what I have learned over the last 10 years is that it is not easy. And I think the theme, if you will, for this afternoon, as Doug Herman also reminded us, is that this is not going to be easy. And none of us, I think, are embarking on this discussion that will start on Monday thinking that it's going to be easy. And I'll just share these last few remarks with you, and then I'm Powell. I'm pragmatic. I'm very pragmatic. I like the intellectual I get titillated by the intellectual themes that come up with our discussion of joint resolutions, and I've done a little bit of research. I'm certainly not an expert, and it's very exciting stuff. It is very, very exciting stuff. But having worked for OHA for 10 years, I really got to see what the front line looks like. And when I talk about the front line, I'm talking about Native Hawaiians. And I think one of the most sad situations that we're faced with back home in Hawaii, and I'm not sure if this is a theme across the United States for Native Hawaiians, but one of the themes that we see very clearly, at least I do, and my background is in education. And so one of the themes that I was always very, very interested in was educational achievement for Native Hawaiians. And what I listed a whole bunch of statistics here, and I'm not going to go through it with you, but what is very clear is that our children, our Native Hawaiian children in this American system are not achieving what we want them to achieve, what they should want to achieve for themselves. When we look at wealth for Native Hawaiians, we have the largest percentage below the poverty line in Hawaii. When we talk about homelessness, Native Hawaiians have the highest percentage of the homeless population in Hawaii. Now, that's living under the American form of government that has been with us for over 100 years. So is it going to be better if we have a nation within a nation? I'm not sure. I'm really not sure. But I know that it couldn't get any worse. And so my personal conviction here is that we do need to do something. And it may not be turning over the state of Hawaii to the people of Hawaii or to the Hawaiians in Hawaii or the Hawaiians across the world. It may not be that, but we need to do something. And so even though I am not looking forward to the discussions that will occur at the Native Hawaiian Convention on Monday, I'm going to stick it out for the month of February, because I want the life for our children to be better. When you look at these numbers, they are very, very sad. And for those of us who have, you know, it's funny because, you know, I'm a product of the public school system in Hawaii. I didn't go to Kamehameha, didn't go to Punahou, went to a public university in Hawaii. So perhaps I have a different perspective. And we get into these discussions, and I'm thinking, you know, for those of us who have gone through those ranks, it's really about paying the bills, putting food on the table, sending your kids to school. You know, and that's not to say that we shouldn't concentrate on bigger things. We by all means should. But we need to deal with housekeeping. And I regret that that's really what needs to be done. And again, I would urge anyone who's interested in looking at what the plight of Hawaiians looks like, the Native Hawaiian data book that's published by the Office of Hawaiian Affairs is online, www.oha.org. If you go online, what you will see when you look at those numbers, and they've really done a great job, and I can take no credit for any of that, because when I left in 2011, it was still in a state of shambles. They have done an excellent job of putting those numbers together, and I would urge you all to go and look. If you even care about what Native Hawaiian sovereignty looks like and Native Hawaiian self-determination and making life better for Native Hawaiians, I would urge you to go and look at that. Now, the last comment I have is this notion of federal recognition. I do not see that as a decision that is made by those delegates sitting at convention. It is not up to them to decide whether or not Native Hawaiians should pursue federal recognition. The Department of Interior has put together a draft of rules regarding federal recognition for Native Hawaiians. It's an answer to the administrative process that Hawai'i has been excluded from for many, many years. So the proposed rules that Interior circulated really is trying to address that issue of administrative recognition of Native Hawaiians. And they want those rules to be promulgated before President Obama leaves office, because they believe that he's sympathetic to the plight of Native Hawaiians, and I believe that that probably is correct. So there is a chance that we may see an administrative process for recognizing Native Hawaiians, but it is not up to those delegates sitting at convention to dictate or to even suggest that the Native Hawaiian people should pursue federal recognition. That decision needs to be made by Native Hawaiians, not by anyone else. It should not be made by 150 people sitting around a table deciding what the articles should be included in that constitution. They simply decide whether or not we have a nation within a nation or not. And it's up to the people to decide whether they want to ratify an article that says that. But assuming that the Native Hawaiian community does accept the nation within a nation model, the next question that they need to answer is, do you want your nation to be federally recognized? It's up to the Native Hawaiian people to decide. So when we talk about the future of sovereignty in Hawaii, the future does look very rosy as far as I'm concerned. Not easy though, it's thorny as well. Because you really need, there's gonna be years yet that this process will go on. We'll have a constitutional convention, we'll have a ratification, and the community will decide, okay, you know, we're gonna form a government and the government's gonna look like this. There'll be, you know, a House of Lords and a House of Nobles, and we're gonna elect these people, and they will form a relationship with the state of Hawaii, the federal government, the municipal governments, etc. That process will go on for, I'll be dead before that is ever completed. But that's fine. And if going through that process means that we address concerns for Native Hawaiians, especially young Native Hawaiians, then I'm all for it. And that's what the future, in my mind, looks like for Native Hawaiian sovereignty. Thank you very much.